going to read this morning from Proverbs 31, beginning with the 25th verse through the 30th verse. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful. Beauty is vain. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. You know, I have to confess, I struggle sometimes when we bring holidays outside the church, into the church. You know, I'm not quite sure how that fits. I feel like sometimes we shoehorn them in there, you know, like with Mother's Day and Father's Day. And I've heard more Mother's Day and Father's Day sermons, I guess, than I could count. And you know, feel like I could probably repeat some of them from memory. But I was thinking this week about, you know, how to approach that subject, because it's, like I say, it's something I struggle with, the other holidays. And it occurred to me that I had never considered the maternal instincts of God. We talk about the love of a mom, and as well we should. And we say there's nothing like it. Well, and that's partially true. Because the thing we have to remember is that the love of moms that we celebrate today is but a reflection of the love of God. That whatever maternal instincts that we speak of, they're God's instincts. God desires to hold us close when we're hurting. God always knows exactly what to say when things aren't going our way. God's always interested. You know, moms will sit there and listen to their kids, you know, rattle on about stuff that they don't care about for hours just because it's important to their kids, and so it's important to them, and they'll listen, and they'll be involved in the conversation. That's, God is like that with us. That maternal instinct to reach out and to hold us close, to care for us when we're sick, to care for us when we're struggling. That's who God is. You know, and with Mother's Day, there's always lots of different emotions. You know, we get to Father's Day, well, we try to keep emotion out of it, don't we, guys? You know. And because we don't see the maternal instincts of God, sometimes we miss out on that emotional connection with Him. Being comfortable with opening up to Him, crying when we're hurting, sharing our laughter with Him. Because we forget that all the things that our mom might mean to us are multiplied and magnified more times than we can count in how God loves us, cares for us. My wife has turned into the crazy bird lady of Dayton. I'll pay for that later, but, you know, facts are facts. What happened was, two or three years ago, our son Caleb said, "Boy, it would really be nice to have some purple martins in the yard." And Deb, being the mom that she is, immediately went out and got a Purple Martin house and put it up. And, you know, we didn't get any Purple Martins. So the next year, she read more about it, and she refined the house a little bit, and she bought, I'm not kidding, she bought recordings of Purple Martins singing and plays them in our yard at 4 o'clock in the morning because that's what they like to hear. I know this for a fact because a couple of times she forgot to put it outside and they started singing in the house at 4 o'clock in the morning. Still no Purple Martins. So this year she built a whole great big new house. And she got new songs and she got decoys. And I mean, it looks like a village of Purple Martins out there. And I pray, dear God, this year please let us get a Purple Martin. But she did all that just because Caleb said, boy, it'd be nice to have some Purple Martins in the yard. And Caleb doesn't even live at home anymore. But it would be something they could talk about, something they could share. As I was walking through the yard this week, I looked up at that Purple Martin house and God says, I'm building one for you, Bowser. Whatever it is you care about. I'm doing more. Caleb has no idea how much work Debbie's done trying to bring these Purple Martins in. And God says, you have no idea how much work I'm doing behind the scenes, the things that you're unaware of, just because I care about what you care about. And so when the Purple Martins fly into our yard this year, I will be reminded of the grace of God. So for those of you who still have your moms with you, still have the privilege, and some of us have had the privilege of caring for our moms as they've aged, and if you still have that privilege, or if she's still with you, I'm telling you today, throw your arms around her, kiss her, let her know how much you love her, what a difference she's made in your life. Now some of us at this point have to wait till glory before we can do that again. So take advantage of this day. For those of you who may not have had the greatest relationship with your mom, let me just remind you that you have no idea what kind of Purple Martin box God is building. And though you may have been estranged from her, maybe you haven't seen her for years or talked to her, maybe she's since gone. Who knows? But you don't know what God has accomplished in her life. So let the hard times go and give them to God. And for those of us that wait for glory to see our moms again, may we find comfort in this day. May we find joy in this day in knowing that our moms are exactly where they always wanted to be. And they're just waiting for us to join them someday. And it doesn't get any better now. So I hope you don't mind the first song this morning. It's only 30 seconds long. You'll be glad to hear. But it is a recording that Isaac did on his phone just a few months before my mom went home to be with the Lord, and we used to sing together. So we're going to start with that one today. Thank you. That song used to give me theological fits when I was a kid. It says the Son of God discloses. I was sure that that song was saying the Son of God is Moses, and I was so confused. I really was. It took me a long time to figure that out. All right, wave announcements this morning, and they're on your sheet there. Still accepting donations for the parking lot. Just designate them as such when you put them in the receptacle. Doesn't that sound much better than the garbage can? Yard sale's coming up on Friday the 21st. Everything is there that you need to know. Please, no clothing this year. And you can call Sandy Brumbaugh or Claudia with any questions. Beth's handling the important part of it, the baked goods. Her number's there, too, so check with her any questions on that. We started Sunday school last week. Had some pretty interesting discussion. Since it's a little cold and wet today, I guess we will actually venture back inside and just kind of spread out in the chapel for Sunday school. So if that sounds all right with everybody. We do need someone or some people to help weed. This year around church, just to keep things looking good. We also had a request from one of the ladies here lives in the area for help mowing. So if anyone is willing to volunteer to mow someone's yard for her, please see me and we'll make sure that happens. We're going to have a meeting Wednesday night. I didn't put this on there because I forgot. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, we're going to discuss the upcoming concert and the upcoming Strawberry Festival. Just to get the ball rolling on that stuff, make sure that we have everything ready to roll for that, because it'll be here sooner than we know. Okay? All right. Prayer request this morning from Angie. She thanks you for your prayers for Bruce, and we need to continue to hold him up as he continues through his chemo, and he's facing surgery here in the near future. So please continue to pray for Bruce, and also she's asking for prayer for Blair Green, friend of Bruce's, who is battling COVID and is really fighting a serious battle with that. Continue to pray for Larry's sister Mary Ann as she continues what has turned into a long battle for her, but we are seeing progress there. So please continue to pray for her as well. All right, let's join our hearts together, shall we? Almighty God, we thank you this day for all of your blessings to us. As I said to someone pulling in, today we have showers of blessings. But we do thank you, God. You have always been faithful. You have always cared for us. You have always provided for us. You have always strengthened us. You have always loved us. We thank you for that. We thank you for being with us during the difficult times, during the difficult challenges in life. We thank you that even in the darkest of days, you'll give us a glimpse. You'll give us something. You'll give us a reason to smile, a reason to remember that you are present with us. For that, we give you thanks. Father, we pray for Blair and for Marianne as they continue this struggle with this nasty virus. God, I ask this day, at this moment, that the Holy Spirit of God will rest upon them in a very powerful and real way, that they will be strengthened, that they will be encouraged, that this will be the moment that things suddenly took a turn for the better. We ask you to be their strength. We ask you to be their help. We ask you to give the doctors wisdom as they continue to work with them, and the nurses, the patients, and the love that they need to care for them. And we pray for Bruce. We thank you for being with him as you have on this journey. Ask that you will continue. We know that you will. We ask your blessing on the family as well. You encourage them and strengthen them. God, you bless us in ways we don't even see, that we aren't even aware of. We thank you for all the purple Martin boxes that you have built in our lives. We give you thanks. We give you praise, Lord God. We worship you. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. cry cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered here, protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining, nothing there can harm me. I am safe forever in your love land.
That's a fun song. My son Isaac was walking through the room yesterday, living room yesterday, when I was working on the music for today. He said, "What is that, Christian polka music?" No, it's not polka. It's gospel. So, I'll read to you this morning from the book of Luke, the 8th chapter, the first 3 verses. After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary of Magdala, from whom 7 demons had come out. Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household. Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means.
I could never speak it, but I didn't quit when they called me heretic. They said I was too dangerous, so I stood with all the women at a distance. Once my name crossed his lips, how could I keep quiet? He is not ashamed to be seen with me beside him. I have seen.
Beside him, oh, I have seen.
know, when I was sitting there, I remembered I forgot to tell you something, and then I stood up and forgot it. So, man, it's going. Okay. Well, the verses that we read today, they're in the beginning of the 8th chapter of Luke. They tell a very short story. You know, as I was thinking about the day and thinking about different women in Scripture that you could preach of, you know, and talk about, you know, all the different moms that are mentioned in Scripture. Of course, it'd be easy to start with Mary, you know, I mean, start there, that's a good one. I thought about Eve, but maybe not. You know, a lot of different moms in Scripture that are talked about, a lot of different women that we could discuss. But I came to this one. This one who, to our knowledge, was never a mom, never had kids. I mean, she might have after the Scriptures are written, we don't know. There's a lot of speculation about who she was. We hear her name, and you know, and I was tempted, if the weather had been nicer today, I was going to ask each of you as you pulled in what you knew about her. Or what was your first perception of the woman that we have come to know as Mary Magdalene? Her name, of course, was Mary, you know, like about 60% of the women back then in Israel, it seemed. There were Marys everywhere. And she was another one. Magdalene was not her last name. She was from a town called Magdala. And just as Jesus was the Nazarene because he was from Nazareth, she was the Magdalene because she was from Magdala. Mary of Magdala. I don't know what your perception of her is. I don't know what you've heard or been told or what you've seen in movies or on TV shows. But these verses that we read here are our introduction to this woman who would play such an incredibly important role in you and I being in this parking lot today. She had 7 spirits that Jesus cast out of her. It, you know, it's just, that's it. That's the full description. It's just like, oh yeah, he cast 7 spirits out of her. Wow, wouldn't you love to know more about that? But I guess God decided we really didn't need to know the particulars. All we needed to know was that she was in need, that she was desperate, that she was at this low point in her life, and he set her free. He cast these spirits out of her, and she followed him because of it. Interesting, you know, the disciples, all those guys, you know, Jesus called them, and they followed him. But she followed him because he had set her free. She knew what it meant to hear the voice of Christ calling her out of the darkness. She knew what it meant to feel life and hope coming back into her because of that man. And I'm going to follow him, and I am going to hear what he says, and I am going to listen, and I am going to apply it, because he brings me life. And too often we forget that God called us out of darkness into his glorious light, as the scripture says. That we were like Mary. We had our own demons, didn't we? We had our own struggles. And he called us out of that darkness into light. May we follow him with the same passion that Mary followed him with. She left behind everything to follow him. The verses that we read, she was a financial supporter of the ministry of Christ. put our money where our mouth was. And she followed Jesus and listened to him so intently, they became very close. Imagine what it was like for her. You know? You got these 12 guys following Jesus around, and then you got Mary following around with them. Any sisters here want to sign up to have 12 brothers? But she put up with them, so that she could be with him. Nothing would stop her. That song we just listened to, nothing could talk her out of it. Nothing would stop her from being with him. So much so that on the day of his crucifixion, as all but one of the disciples had run away, there was Mary. She would not abandon him in his hour of darkness, because he had not abandoned her in her hour of darkness. She stayed with him until the end. She stayed as they took his body down from the cross. She stayed and watched. She stayed as they wrapped his body in this burial cloth. She followed them to the tomb. She watched where he was laid. She would not leave him. Where else would she go? He had saved her from death. And if she could now in any way bring comfort to him in his death, she would do so. She went and so now, knowing where he was buried, even though she wasn't from Jerusalem, she made note of where it was. She memorized the her steps back to that upper room. So that on the third day she could go back to that tomb. Maybe that sheds a little different light on why it was that she was so insistent that they go back and they anoint his body for burial. This was her Lord. This was her friend. This was her Savior. She had to go. Boy, I wish I had that passion sometimes. You just have to go. Nothing will stop you. She had no idea what awaited her at the tomb. But yes, she went. And there in that moment, the angels spoke to her. As she left, she heard the voice of Christ. How beautiful is that? She had heard his voice calling her out of death, calling her out of darkness, calling her out of all of the evil spirit struggles that she had. She had heard that voice bringing her life, and now she heard that voice bringing her life again, announcing that he was alive. If you're Jesus, who better to talk to first? Think about it. She's the first person that he talked to after the resurrection. She'll know my voice. She will know my voice. Though it came unexpectedly, she knew it. I wonder when the voice of God shows up in unexpected places if we will recognize it. If we will hear him speaking to us in the middle of what we see as despair and hopelessness, and suddenly find that he is there and there is always hope. And then he gives her this message to take to the disciples. I don't know if you've ever really thought about that. Think back to the culture of the day. You know, when the women went to the synagogue, you know, the men sat up front. They sat close to the teachers. They asked the questions. The women had to stay in the back. And if they had any questions, they had to ask their husbands when they got home. I wonder if any of the wives here would ask your husbands any question about the sermon today, if they'd be able to answer. But that's what they had to do. They couldn't hear it for themselves. But not Jesus. We read of how, you know, the Mary and Martha, how Mary sat at his feet. I mean, she sat right there with the men. We read these verses of these women who went with them, who supported him. Jesus treated them the same as men. There was no difference. Does the scripture not say there is neither male nor female to those who are in Christ Jesus? He wasn't dividing them as the teachers of the day would. And now the most important message that would ever be proclaimed on earth. And Jesus picks Mary to make it. No other teacher of that day would choose a woman to speak for him. But Jesus did. She knows my voice. She has heard my heart. She has followed me all of this time. If I tell her to go and tell the disciples something, she'll go. That's why I titled the sermon today, The 13th Disciple. He knew. She'll go. What an amazing turn of events. From this woman lost in darkness, struggling every moment of her life, to being the first person on earth to proclaim the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever struggles we may face, whatever moments may come when all hope seems lost, let us think of Mary, who went from that darkness to that incredible experience, and know that we haven't even begun to dream of what it is that God has for us. Now, I got to tell you that bothered some of the men. (Laughter) out of that has come all kinds of stories about Mary. I was watching a show recently, and there was again, you know, Mary Magdalene, the prostitute. No, there's absolutely no biblical support for that reputation at all. That's something that people threw on her to try to diminish her, to try to somehow make her less because they wanted to be more. But she just kept right on talking. Let them say what they want. Let them think what they want. The Lord Jesus has given me a message, and I will proclaim it. And in early church history, we see her there helping as the church of Christ began to grow. Leading, teaching. Let us not be concerned with what the world may say or what they may think. Let us not worry about people who are trying to pull us down. Let them try. The message of Christ is in our hearts. The message of Christ will not be silenced. We have been called from darkness into His glorious light. Let the world know it. Let us be the 14th disciple. Let us proclaim the same message with the same enthusiasm, the same passion as Mary did. Amen.
If my heart could tell a story, if my life would sing a song, if I have a testimony, if I have anything at all, no one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me out this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in You alone my joy was found. Oh, my joy, my joy. Let my children tell their children. Let this be their memory. That all my treasure was in heaven. And You were everything to me. Never cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in You alone my joy was found. I found my joy. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in you, my joy was found.
Let my children tell my grandchildren. Let them tell their children. It's a great line. Christ alone. Christ alone. So now in His name I bless you. May you walk this week in the sure and certain knowledge of the maternal instincts of God. May you allow Him to hold you close. May you allow Him to give you comfort. May you allow Him to give you strength. May you allow Him to share in everything in your life. May you allow Him to call you from darkness into light. And may you walk in that light. And may you proclaim the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, to the world. The honor and glory of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.